All right, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the February 19th scheduled meeting of your Board of Commissioners. Tonight, we will have our invocation delivered by our county manager, and following that, the Pledge of Allegiance will be led by Commissioner Mark Richardson. If we could all stand and remain standing. Mr. Manager?
Join me in prayer by bowing your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for all your gifts and wisdom that you give us to make good decisions on behalf of our populace of Rockingham County. Please help us to turn to you and search for answers so that when decisions are made, they are made for what is pleasing to you. Look after our Board of Commissioners and our staff to provide the leadership that you have asked them to do on your behalf and help our board make decisions that will make positive impacts to our community. We ask that you bless us, look over us, and give us strength to lead with honesty and integrity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If you would please face the flag and render the appropriate courtesy. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands,
one nation,
under God,
indivisible,
with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated. Gentlemen, the next item on our list is approval of our agenda for tonight, and I don't believe we have any changes. Do we have any changes, gentlemen? Otherwise, we'll entertain a motion.
Move approval, Mr. Chair.
All right, we have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. Thank you. Our next item is our consent agenda, and items on the consent agenda are non-controversial items. However, if anyone has questions about these items, please contact our county manager, Lance Metzler. Are there any items that members want to remove from the consent agenda? Nothing heard. Do we have a motion for approval?
Make a motion to approve.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Thank you. Next item is public comment. And we have no one signed up to speak in public comment tonight. So with that, Lance, you don't have to read the requirements.
Thank you, sir.
All right, the next item takes us to public hearings. Marzi? The first one will be seeking approval of case number 2023-22, zoning text amendment.
Good evening. First we have for you is a text amendment 2023-22. This is a citizen-initiated text amendment to the Unified Development Ordinance to amend the standards for private roads. Specifically, the request is to increase the number of individual parcels of land that may be served by private roads from the current 5 to 8. In your packet and on the screen, you can see the textual changes, how this would affect the UDO, and staff took it upon themselves that should this go through, to change it from road standards within minor subdivisions to residential private road standards, since the section is not actually in the minor subdivision section. And that's pretty much short and sweet. When the planning board heard this at their January 8th meeting and voted 7-0 to recommend approval, we've had one phone call of inquiry about this, and otherwise I'll take a few questions. If you have any.
Yes, Commissioner Barrow.
I want to make sure I understood what you said here in the red where it says residential private road standards. That was added by the
staff? That was added by staff, just to clarify that section. The road standards within minor subdivisions doesn't make sense since we have road standards for minor subdivisions in another section of the ordinance. So this was an opportunity to clear that up if we needed to.
If it passes, we'll change that. If it doesn't pass,
it doesn't really affect anything. This is just like typo error keeping kind of record keeping kind of thing.
Okay.
But I just wanted to point out that was a staff change, not the request of the applicant.
Gotcha. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
All right, Commissioner Powell.
So the current is up to 5, and that, I believe, was that anything above that went into the minor subdivision? Is that the way that worked?
Anything above 5 subdivisions would be a major subdivision now. For us, so 6 or more becomes a major subdivision. So in current standards, if someone's developing a new area, this would, six or more would have state standard roads. This text amendment more or less affects current private roads, because we do have, if you do a minor subdivision, which is 1 to 5 parcels, and it's going to have a new road in it, we do have a standard for that. This is would be affecting, and which would still be affected to 5, because that's the minor subdivision limit before it becomes a major subdivision. But this provision in our ordinance more or less affects current private roads that were prior to our current ordinances.
So let me ask you something. On this situation right here, that there are no road standards, is that correct?
For many of our roads, yes.
And so who in this minor subdivision or group takes care of the roads?
As with all private roads, it's to the people who have access to the private roads are responsible for that road.
So that may be nobody.
It could be nobody. It could be everybody. It's not public road, so it doesn't fall to DOT to maintain.
But yet and still, our EMS and fire personnel would have to gain access to this to help people that live on that, correct?
Correct, as well as the post office delivering mail, trash trucks trying to pick up trash, any service available, not just EMS, but yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
I think some terminology and kind of where things sit is kind of getting muddied a little bit, or potentially getting muddied. Up until this version of the UDO was adopted, the limit was 3.
That's right.
Anything above 3 required any road to be built up to DOT standards. When the UDO was discussed, there was a great deal of discussion about what to do with this number. And at that point in time, it was shifted from 3 to 5. That really didn't have anything to do with minor major subdivision. It was really a matter of, because we've got a number of private roads in the county that have been created from old farms and just sectioning off an acre here, an acre there. And it's just the access to those homes. But it was shifted from 3 to 5 at that point in time.
That's right. That's correct.
Mr. Chair, another question. So, Mars, just for the benefit of the public and some clarification, I know when I watched the planning board meeting, you had made the comment that there was no magic number. But to go back to what Kevin was just saying, Commissioner Berger was just saying, there is a reason why we came up with this number.
Correct. Like he was saying that... It's the thought process for most of it has been drawn out largely as services using the roads, how these roads were developed in the first place, no consistency between them, so they went with the number that would be most manageable is my understanding. For us, when we requested the change to 5 from 3, when we got rid of county roads, which was set at 5, there was like an individual road. We based it solely on the minor subdivision being consistent and in keeping in line with the county road provision that was in the ordinance that we removed. So the thought process is, as I made at the planning board meeting, if they made all of our numbers could be subjective. So, we could have this be 100 parcels, we could have it be 2 parcels. It's really what we feel is best for the public in the general sense of its general welfare, the public health, and things like that.
And the number we came up with was 5.
5 is more than the 3 that it used to be, yes, but it still keeps it under the provision where we require state maintenance.
Yes, sir. And this may be a question for the applicant, but the road currently, is there a maintenance agreement on this road?
Probably be better for the applicant.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Commissioner Richardson.
Yeah, for me, need a simple answer, maybe a simple brain here, I'm not sure. So if we approve this, the owner thereof could put 8 houses on a road that is a private road and not subject to being maintained to a standard that's equivalent to the state standard.
Yes. Yes and no. It's not that the applicant couldn't put 8 houses out there.
I don't want a yes and no answer. The
way you framed the question made it sound like they could put 8 more houses. There could be up to 8 parcels. It's not about houses. It's about the parcels. It's about parcels accessing the road because
define
we do allow for accessory dwelling units and things
define
like that.
Define parcels for me, Marzi.
It's a tract of land.
And this tract of land is adequate for what?
One house and one accessory dwelling unit, so technically two houses. So that's why we differentiate. We don't say houses, we don't say driveways, we say parcels, because there's other rules that we have that can affect the number of dwelling units that can go on to a parcel.
But at least eight could go there.
Up to eight, yes. There's currently five parcels on the applicant's road, but there's many more that have 19. There's some others that only have three or four. There's hundreds of these private roads in the county that this would affect.
I got you. Thank you.
Mr. Powell?
But what we were trying to do, or what the planning board was trying to do, or the group that was updating the UDO when it was updated was trying to do, was to limit the amount on a private road because there were issues, or could be issues, mm-hmm. with accessing that with emergency vehicles, mail, other things. Because in my experience in some of this, you know, one person ends up trying to maintain the road and maybe nobody else helps. I'm not saying that's the case in this particular thing, but without a standard and without an agreement, there's no guarantee that the road's even passable to emergency vehicles. Is that correct?
Sure.
Okay.
Any more questions? All right, we'll open the public hearing at this time. And we do have four people signed up to speak. So I'll ask our attorney, Clyde Albright, to read the protocol for public hearing comments. Clyde?
All those desiring to speak at the public hearing should have already signed in at the sign-up sheet located at the rear entrance of the chambers. You've heard the specific ordinance being considered. You'll be allowed 15 minutes to speak and present the case. The applicant will be. And the public who signed up to speak will have 3 minutes to speak or yield his or her time to another individual. However, there'll be no more than 30 minutes allotted for public comments. Each speaker should clearly state the name and physical address. Once the public's had the opportunity to voice either in favor or against the proposed amendment, the applicant will be allotted an additional 7 minutes if they wish to provide a rebuttal. And following the public hearing, the hearing will be closed and the Board of Commissioners shall be afforded an opportunity to discuss the request. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Albright. We are in the public hearing now. We do have Mr. Robert Bean. If you'd like to make your way up, give us your name and address, and if someone else is lending you their time.
My wife is going to be letting me have her time. My name is Robert Bean. My friends call me Pete. This is my wife, Sandra. We live at 2740 Gideon Grove Church Road in Stokesdale on the farm that we bought in 1982. This is where I grew up and where I've lived most of my life. This farm is where my grandparents moved to in 1927 and lived as sharecroppers. I sent all you gentlemen a packet with emails, pictures, information, etc., 3 or 4 weeks ago regarding the issue of the 30-foot easement. We're here this evening to ask that you vote against this increase. This amendment, however it's referred to, this will directly affect our property as we have a 30-foot easement through approximately 850 feet of our property with no type of maintenance or maintenance agreement or regulations whatsoever. This is nothing more than an old farm road. This easement was given in 1968 to access the farm behind our farm. This road is already overburdened with 6 residences. It is already 1 over the present limit of 5. No one has ever been able to explain how that recently happened either. There's 6 residents currently on this limit of 5 road. Adding more residents on this type of road, it'll only make a bad situation worse, and this is a bad situation. This road is already a huge safety issue. On average, 25 vehicles daily travel through it. And I can look out my kitchen window and see these vehicles. The road is only wide enough for one vehicle. Many of them are delivery and postal vehicles traveling approximately 30-plus miles an hour, even though I have two 10-mile-an-hour speed limit signs posted on the road. I have a 32-year-old son with Down syndrome and three young grandchildren who live on this farm also. We are taking our lives in our hands, just checking the mail or emptying the garbage. In my hand to God, that is true. I have personally about been run over two or three times out there. I can tell people to slow down. I've been cursed out. I've had a gun pulled on me, not by any of the residents now, but former residents. This has all happened on my wife and my property. I've put speed bumps in only to have a resident come with their tractor, knock them down, curse me out, and tell me don't do that again. This amendment is going to affect others in this county, same as us. At the very least, we need to consider some guidelines for maintenance and particularly safety. And what I've heard, no disrespect to Mr. Marziano, but there's no rules, regulations. You gentlemen, I mean, y'all heard this as well as we did. We and others would appreciate your voting no on this issue. I have spoken to at least three attorneys and one local land surveyor on this matter, and all said this was too many houses on this 30-foot farm road. Now, I'll be glad to answer any questions, or I'll be glad to have each and every one of you come out to the property. We have a beautiful farm. My wife and I have worked 40-plus years to have a nice home and a place for our family, and I hope my family can continue to be there for years to come. And with that being said, I mean, the EMS things, the fire truck things, you gentlemen have pictures that I sent you of what part of this road looks like. Waste management will not even go down this road now to pick up cans. They all have to set at the intersection of Bean Lane and Gideon Grove Church Road because there's nowhere to turn around down there. Much of this road, if you want to call it a road, it's all a fire truck could do to get down there or turn around or a garbage truck. It's just an old farm road that was used there years ago, and that's what it is. Nobody's done anything to it. One of the residences has put some gravel on it a few years ago. In the wintertime, it's just a mess. If it rains, it's a mess. There's potholes, everything else. The road is wide enough to get one vehicle on. Anything else has to pull off into a field or on the side of the road. I appreciate your time on this. I'm a live and let live kind of man, but, you know, this is really gone on far enough. And now for this to happen, I mean, and with that being said, I will mention that Mr. Berger, I had consulted with him on this matter at one point, and he looked into some things for me. So I don't know the protocol here as far as him being involved in the vote or whatever, but I appreciate your time. And I just hope you'll take all this into consideration. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Bean.
Charlie, we can just clarify.
Yeah,
I believe I got Mr. Bean and Ms. Bean in touch with folks with planning and zoning and got the answer from planning and zoning. If you could clarify that for them, Mr. Bean.
You got some information. You did help us get some information. That's correct. What he said is correct. I won't go into the planning and zoning thing because that's a whole nother story in of itself right there. And I think y'all had all the emails I sent you. That situation was handled completely, what's the term I would use, just bad.
Mr. Bean, I just have a further clarification. You've not given him any money as an attorney on this case. Is that what
I have?
Yes, we did.
It was a consultation and then got him in touch with planning and zoning. So, I mean, I'll be glad to recuse myself from that.
That's my clarification. Thank you.
And let me also say, you are not the applicant. I think Mr. Michael Doyle, are you the applicant? Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Well, because I should have technically let you go first. You have 15 minutes. Is that right, Mr. Attorney? Right. So if you'd like to make your way up, give us your name and address. And thank you, Roy.
Good evening. I appreciate you hearing me. Name's Michael Doyle. I live on 270 Bean in Stokesdale, down an old farm road. When we originally bought 45 acres on this property, it was deeded that we could transfer it to our heirs, and that our plan was to have our sons build next to us. My mother was fortunate enough to get the property next to us. So on this parcel, basically three of them are mine. But we had intended out of this 45 acres to, you know, allow our sons to be able to live next to us, one of our best friends. We're not looking to build apartment buildings, anything like that. So the way I understand it is that the law changed several years ago, and which directly affected my property. Had I applied 3 years ago, it would have gone through without any problems. So the issue with the private roads, we have acreage. I'm not looking to divide an acre at a time. The road itself is very well maintained, except for the front 100 yards. I personally have maintained the road for 20 years, pretty much almost by myself. The front end gets potholes. EMS comes in without any problem. We had a fire once, and five fire trucks from around the world showed up. They sat in my lawn and had fun while the other guys put the fire out. My own father lived down the road, and EMS got to him without any problem at all. In fact, two weeks ago, the elder man down at the end, very end of the road, EMS got to him, no problem. Delivery trucks are a problem in the world these days. They're everywhere. It has nothing to do with a private road. It's just the highways. So the main issue is now being limited to five parcels. I own three. A gentleman down the road owns one, and Mr. Bean owns a mobile home on the front. So I'm basically locked in by a mobile home. And again, originally when I bought it, it was deeded completely different. So we were blindsided when we weren't able to change it. In fact, the commissioners were a little confused too. All I can say is there are people all over this county affected by the same thing. I think there are other possible ways to handle the issue, maybe by acreage. But at this time, this is what we're talking about. How many actual lots on a private road? On this private road, I personally own probably 80% of all the property on that private road. And I'm being limited. My son's getting ready to graduate college. My younger one's in high school. Family, as we've planned all along, are starting to come to fruition and wanting to be by us. And that's what this is all about for us personally. It could be a state road for all I care. I just want to have my family next to me. Can I answer any questions or anything in particular?
Gentlemen, do we have any questions at this time? We have one more person signed up to speak.
I got one.
Go ahead.
Yes, how many houses are on this road?
There's two mobile homes. There's three mobile homes and two houses. Wait, let me count that out. One, two, three mobile homes. And three houses. Yeah.
Six.
So one's an accessory to our farm.
Someone lives there.
It's an accessory to our farm. Our barn manager lives there. So it's, as I understand it, perfectly fine when we did it. So, I mean, we got permits and everything. Yes, sir.
Go ahead, Commissioner.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This may actually be a question for Marzia, but the comment that you made, I was just a little confused by it. You said that they changed the if this would have been done 3 years ago, it would have been different, but the deed changed. I'm not sure if I understand what that means. Marzi, could you clarify what he's talking about?
Yes, sir. I'm not sure, because 3 years ago, it was three was the limit. At the UDO change in 2000...
Marzi, Roy, stop the timer for now. All right, go ahead, Marzi.
UDO change in 2021 created the private roads at three lots, a county road at five lots, and then anything more was state maintained. As no county roads were existing, and we made some clerical changes to the UDO back in, I guess, early 22 or late 21 to that effect, bringing just private roads to five. But 3 years ago, it would have been three lots. Follow-up
question to that, I suppose. Mr. Doyle, you said you've been there about 20 years? At any time in the last 20 years, would this have qualified, if you could answer that?
My deed was specific.
Sorry, real quick. We don't look at deeds in our office. We're not allowed to enforce deeds, control deeds, or even review deeds like for covenants and things like that. A lot of these parcels were sometimes subdivided many years ago, and these private roads existed prior to zoning. I don't really can't speak to how the 90s may have been. We don't have a lot of record keeping that speaks to that kind of stuff either. But 88 was when we instituted zoning. That's when a lot of these stuff would have became non-conforming number of lots on roads. So if take a lot of the subdivisions where there's like 20 parcels currently on them, on these private roads, they date back to the 60s and 70s when they were subdivided off. So there's a lot of that goes around. And sometimes some things may have fallen through the cracks, but no, 3 years ago and prior should have been three roads, at least three parcels, at least since the 2006 ordinance.
Okay, so since 2006, three roads.
That's the furthest back I've read. I haven't gone back to the 90s.
I'm just trying to get a time frame clarification. Right. So since 2006, three would have been the limit.
It's my understanding, yes. UDO.
Okay, that was my question. Thank you. I'm sorry. One more question, Mr. Doyle. You said that there's currently not a maintenance agreement on this road.
No,
but
sir.
You would be.
There is on my end.
Okay, but as far as amongst the neighbors, there's not any sort of agreement. But you would be okay with a state standard road. Is that what you just said?
I'd be perfectly fine with it.
Okay,
bother me a bit,
Mr. Doyle. You,
yes,
hang
sir.
On. You have 10 more minutes remaining.
Yes, sir.
On your time, if you want to. You use that, or if you're through with your presentation, that's fine. I just, if you want to continue speaking, I'll ask Roy to put 10 minutes on the clock.
Yes, sir. That's fine. I just wanted to clarify a few things. My specific deed, the way it was worded, and actually I sent a copy to Lynn. I imagine they have it on file. Originally, it said you could divide it up to all heirs and the other word. I don't remember what it is. I'm sorry.
So when I saw the planning board, you're talking about how you could split your property.
Yes, sir.
But that wasn't about the road. It wasn't an agreement about the road.
No, it had nothing to do
with the road. I just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah, it was just how I could split my personal property and, you know, to my heirs or whatever.
Yes, sir.
So in the way I understood it in 2021... a law changed, and I'm not sure what he's talking about at all.
We're talking specifically. I was asking him specifically about the road. I'm not. You can still subdivide your property if that's what your deed says. I'm asking him about our ordinance for the road.
Yeah. Well, they stopped. See, that's what I'm trying to do is divide my personal property, and they stopped it because of the limit on the road.
So we're talking about two different issues.
Okay.
You can divide your property. You can legally do that. But the road doesn't allow it because of the way that our ordinance is. But
correct.
So this, we're not stopping you from dividing your property. We're saying that because of the road standards that they currently are, that's why you're trying to change the road standards. I know this sounds all very technical, but that's clarification, right?
He can deed it.
I think you're trying to make a simple question with a complex situation. Yes, he could subdivide his property if he has access from another road.
Yes.
Yes, he can subdivide his property with the heirs and assigns through a will.
Yes.
Once he's passed away, a judge can divide that property. There's exempt plats that are possible. However, we don't have to allow development if it doesn't meet our regulations. That's the sticky wicket that this situation becomes, is he is able to subdivide under certain conditions. Those conditions do not exist.
I understand. Thank you.
Also, just to point out again, regardless of the deed, we're not beholden to deeds.
I understand.
Okay.
Thank you.
Excuse me. Well, I just...
You may continue.
I just wanted to kind of summarize a little bit, and what this is really breaks down to is just I want my family close to me. That's it. And I'm not asking for a lot, just a couple. You know, it's a big piece of property. We have, it's a large horse farm. There's plenty of room for everybody, and as far as road maintenance, I got no problem taking care of it. Personally, none at all. And more than willing to put that on paper. But I appreciate y'all's attention and your thought, and hopefully you'll consider this for me. You have a good night.
Thank you, Mr. Dole. We have one more applicant signed up, Jody Morris. You're good? Okay. Well, you're on here, so I have to ask. Okay, with that, we're going to close the public hearing at this time.
Can I say one more thing, sir?
I don't...
Fine.
Well, maybe two. Mr. Doyle
has stated this road is well-maintained. I sent you gentlemen pictures of the road. I think you see what his idea of well-maintained is. And if I have pictures here again, and I'd be glad to share them with you. He says he owns 80% of the property on this road. I own 45 acres of property on Gideon Grove Church Road, 20 on one side of this easement, 25 on the other side. So I don't know where the 80% is coming from. I don't know where the well-maintained is coming from. And also he wants his family close to him. But this all came about because one of his employees, he is either giving them or selling them property, and they hit a roadblock when they went to get permits, et cetera. Not that they hadn't already went in there and cleared a lot, put in a driveway, et cetera, before any of this was ever even brought up. And I might add, I never get notified about anything. This goes directly through my property. Nobody says, well, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. That's the way it's been for 40-plus years for me. So,
all right. Thank you, Mr. Boone.
Thank you.
All righty.
I'd like to
rebut. Got to let him at this point. Oh,
come right on.
I'm sorry.
He's 7 minutes anyway.
The well-maintained section versus the unmaintained. The unmaintained is his side. There's a clear turn.
Like to see the pictures,
it's a clear turn. I run my tractor up there monthly. I've never had a complaint by a waste management, by an ambulance driver, by a FedEx guy. I've never had a single complaint about my road. I try to take care of that property best I can. We do happen to have to drive through his farm. His home is not connected to this road. He has a separate entrance. So literally...
I have a residence on Bean Lane myself.
It's his time to speak.
He has a rental property.
Yeah, on Bean. He does. But his personal residence is not there. It's not on this road. It's not his address. So, again, I'm kind of locked in by just the circumstances. And I'm not trying to disrupt anybody. I'm not trying to make things hard. The one he was discussing that was my employee is actually, I consider him my brother. It's family. I've known them for 20 years. We may not be biological, but we are family. So I speak the honest truth when I say that's all I'm looking for is to get my family close to me. So sorry for the trouble, and y'all have a good night. Appreciate it. Take care.
With that, we've had the applicant, we've had responses, and Mr. Attorney?
A comment was made about recusal. Commissioner Berger is required to vote unless he has some direct financial interest. in this issue, and I've heard nothing that indicates he has a direct financial interest in the outcome.
Mr. Berger, do you have direct financial interest in the outcome?
The Beans approached me, had a consultation pertaining to the number of lots that are allowed. This was, I don't know the date. This has been months ago. And then this is a text amendment that deals with every piece of property or potentially every piece of property in the county. Put them in touch with Planning and Zoning Department. I don't know what kind of records you've got as far as when people contact you, but it had to do with...
It was back in early November, I believe, is when we first got contacted by Mr. Bean.
Okay. And when did this text amendment start?
December. It came in December, so...
Yeah.
Shortly after we denied the plat.
Okay. So my contact was before the text amendment started. It was just a matter of what's allowed, you know, how can we get a clear answer, and got them in touch with planning and zoning. So,
having heard that, Mr. Chairman, I think he's required to vote.
Thank you, Mr. Attorney. Do any of the other commissioners have any concerns with regards to Commissioner Berger's voting?
No.
Well, nothing heard. Mr. Berger, you will be required to vote then.
Okay.
All right. So we have closed the public hearing, right? I think I remember doing that. We'll go to Commissioner Powell.
Morrissey, I got several questions on this because I think it goes to exactly what I said a while ago. First of all, we hear there's six residences on here. I think that's probably the sixth one, maybe a play on some of the words in our UDO. So explain that.
There are six address points connected to Bean.
Okay.
Five parcels.
Okay, five parcels.
Tracts of land.
All right, so it goes by parcel and not address points.
Correct.
Okay. And is this road capable of being made a state-maintained road? I know it's only a 30-foot easement.
My understanding is I believe the state has provisions for smaller roads like that. Some gravel roads are 20-foot and 25-foot right-of-ways. I don't know if their current regulations have that. However, in order to do that, all the property owners would have to petition DOT and also bring the road up to state standards before DOT will take it over. So while it may be possible, I'm unsure about the road base, anything that's been out there, so it may take considerable work to do so.
Have you seen this area?
Yeah, I drove out there.
So Mr. Bean says that they have to drive through his property. I'm assuming his property is the first coming off Gideon Grove Road.
He's right there on Gideon Grove Road. It's two tracks across Bean. There's an address point on Bean, which is one of their houses.
And is that at the corner of Gideon Grove and Bean, or is it on down Bean Road some?
It's just about, about 50, 100 feet after the corner. It's the one would be considered on the corner, but yeah.
So really, in all honesty, without a maintenance agreement in effect, there's no obligation on Mr. Bean's part to do anything to this road because he don't need it to access his property. The people that below him need it to access their property. Is that correct?
That one's above my pay grade on that one. I'd say that there's no agreement on the road, so therefore there's no responsibility of anybody to do anything if they don't want to.
And that goes to exactly what I was saying before. When we do these, you know, the more houses we put on them, the more you have the possibility of the roads good being in poor shape. And in this case, it seems to me that Mr. Bean has no obligation to fix his part of the road because he doesn't need it, unless I guess he accesses his farm that way. And that kind of the situation that you run into, it appears to me, I've had some dealings with this in the county on other areas, it appears to me this is exactly the problems that you get when you start trying to increase these, which may lead credence to why the UDO limited it to five even after raising it from three.
Yeah, there's, barring this specific road that the neighbors here are discussing, we asked GIS how many private roads we have in the county. There's over 1,000. How many that may be outside the municipal jurisdictions? We're looking at, you know, 800, 900 at least. There's a lot of situations where this comes up. We get this request at least twice a month where we have to deny somebody doing this. We don't like doing that, but we also explain to them, and usually it's understood why we keep the road limited for everybody's ability to use it and seek alternative access points, exclusive use easements across someone else's parcel, maybe the development of another road, things like that. But yeah, this affects a lot of places, and there's a lot of places I won't drive my truck down when I go look at the property, so.
One last question, and then I'll stop. Is there a solution to this besides this text amendment?
The solution we've got currently is when private roads are being developed, they have to put some kind of road maintenance understanding on the plat, but we can't require people to enter into agreements with each other. The developer we usually can make something happen with, but most people are interested in doing more than private roads so that we get the state standards out of. I don't know of another way to help the existing roads where they may have 20 lots, they may have seven, they may have whatever. We've bumped our heads across this one for 3 years.
But is there another way that this gentleman can get somebody on his property, that 45 acres, without this text amendment? I mean, if they all agreed to bring it up to state standards,
yeah,
that would be one way.
Like I said, exclusive use easement from some other point, possibly anything. I don't, off the top of my head, I really couldn't give you an answer. Like I said, we see this a lot, usually exempt plats that have the possibility of meeting state statutes may be possible, but I couldn't, without any like actual review of something, I couldn't give you a guaranteed answer.
Thank you.
Commissioner Burrow.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So after hearing all the comments on this, you know, it's obviously a tricky situation. We have Mr. Doyle, who wants to be able to use this property, which I understand that, and we have a road, which I feel is really the, I don't think the UDO is the problem in the situation. I think the problem in the situation is the road. When I had a conversation with Mr. Bean previously, he told me that he would be willing to enter into a maintenance agreement on this road. Do you agree with that, Mr. Bean? We had that conversation.
Depending on the terms and circumstances.
I understand. But you would be open to a conversation about it.
I would be open to a conversation.
The reason I ask is because obviously, this is a specific request for a specific situation, and it would definitely solve the problem for Mr. Doyle, but I'm not sure that passing this ordinance would not create more problems across the whole county, because this wouldn't just be for this road. This would be for the entire county.
It's for the whole county.
So that's what I was looking for clarification. So thank you, Mr. Bean.
Got a question. Make a motion. I'll comment before I make a motion. Well, I don't think we have any further discussion. Do we? Anyone else have any questions?
I'll make a comment. It's an observation. I haven't been involved in this question personally, per se, but I've been involved in several similar situations, some adjacent to this property, where a non-state maintained road was creating problems for the inhabitants, the residents thereon. And I, for one, am not interested in creating any more of those situations, and concur with what Commissioner Barrow was talking about. If there can be a solution to the road that's agreeable to everyone, mighty fine, then we can move forward. I understand the applicant's concern, but having dealt with a lot of them, I appreciate his attitude about maintaining his section of the road and being willing to keep doing that, but that agreement's only good as long as he's alive. And it's up to him how well he fulfills that agreement. So I'm making this statement in support of what Mr. Barrow is doing, and await your motion.
Gentlemen, I'm willing to accept a motion to approve or deny.
Mr. Chair, I make a motion to deny the text amendment to the UDO.
Very good. We have a motion. Is there a second?
You do.
We have a motion and a second. With that, we'll call for a vote. All in favor of denial of case 2023-22, please say aye.
Aye.
All in favor? I mean, all opposed? Nay. and nothing heard. So that, the motion is denied. Our next case is case 2024-01A.
Thank you. I'm going to defer to Mr. Cochran on this one and the next one, if that's all right. These were his, the products of his mind, so.
Oh, my. Products of my mind. I'm afraid to think about that. Good evening, everyone. The next two amendments in order are 2024-01A and 2024-01B. A concerns RV parks and campgrounds. Those of you who've been around for the planning process with the new ordinance back in 21 and since then know that we've been through several phases of,
Back up one, there you go.
There you go, I dropped a P, sorry about that. We've been through several phases of considering how RV parks should be permitted and developed. Initially in 21, very few standards were added. Later in 21, we realized that we needed to add certain basic standards as far as roadway access, things like wastewater management and the like. Since then, we have been working with these significantly in the time period between late 2021 and now, and this is a staff-sponsored text amendment. We feel like that there is room to bolster and improve these standards in a way that helps make these parks more attractive to sort of merge with the community in a somewhat better fashion in some cases, and to also allow for a certain amount of public input when considering the development of an RV park, which is currently not allowed. This amendment would take an RV park permit approval from an administrative approval with specific developmental standards to a conditional zoning approval, meaning that it would go through both the planning board and this board for review and consideration, which would allow specific dedicated times for public input should they have concerns about it, something that's not allowed now. It also sets a higher standard for the applicant in moving through that process and dealing with the few suggestions that we have made to clarify, number one, some of the definitions separating out set definitions for campgrounds and recreational vehicle parks, creating parallel but distinct standards for each that are a little bit separate. Nothing will really change with the group or tent camping, primitive campground. Those rules pretty much stay the same, but the RV park rules would now include a couple of just clarifications. Number three, just moving that wording around is to clarify that sentence. It was sort of poorly constructed. What we're adding is a request or a suggestion that roadways, currently a 30-foot private right-of-way as required by the private road standards, be paved with asphalt, concrete, or any other material that DOT might recognize as suitable for paving. We would like to add a maximum length of stay of 180 days, which is not a wholly arbitrary number. That comes from a parallel in the floodplain. Anytime an RV or mobile structure of any kind might be located in a floodplain, the maximum length of stay that it can have in that area is 180 days. So we're sort of paralleling that to have some sort of benchmark for, and this wouldn't be something that we go out and police and say, do you have anybody over 180 days? It's like everything would be complaint-based. If we get a complaint that someone stayed over, we'll check it out. Just a notation that establishment of an RV park is now subject to conditional zoning or rezoning approval. And an emphasis, this was already included in the ordinance, but an emphasis that you must provide us with a detailed site plan that then becomes part of the conditional rezoning process and subject to amendment at both the planning board and board of commissioners levels. And here you can just see a breakdown of the table of how this would sort of lay out. It would separate RV park from campground, comma, primitive and group, which would maintain development standards. Then park, recreational vehicle, travel trailer, camper would be conditional zoning. That's what the new C represents. And poultry breeding facilities is only included because we need to renumber some things for formatting in the actual supplemental use table of the UDO. We have not had any phone calls or inquiries about this. I can say at present that we have 6 RV parks somewhere in the permitting process, either early on, in the middle, or sort of later on. And we have 2 to 3 that we're seriously discussing. With that, I'll be glad to answer any questions you all might have.
Gentlemen, do we have any questions? Commissioner Berger, it looks like you're drawing a breath.
Well, I mean, I think you can go ahead with the public hearing aspect. I've noticed some errors in the text amendment, so.
Wouldn't be surprised if there's a boo-boo or two in there.
About the permitting process that you were just referencing.
Sure.
If there's a change to the UDO, once someone is already in the permitting process, how does that affect the permitting process?
If someone has already submitted a formal application to us in the form of a site plan or request for development approval, and we have granted that, that gives them vested rights and essentially what's called permit choice. They would get the choice to develop in the way that they would choose. They could choose to go with the new rules or stick with the old rules. That's spelled out by state statute as to how that works, and we simply follow that statute.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Sure.
Thank you. With that, we'll open the public hearing. There is no one signed up to speak. Is there anyone here who would like to speak on it? Since this is staff generated, I guess staff is the applicant, and you've already presented.
Sure. And thank you for catching any boo-boos I might have made, Commissioner Berger.
Well, with that, we'll go ahead and close the public hearing. And now we'll ask for any questions.
Well, I mean, I think there's some minor errors in the definitions. You know, the campground has 2 or more campsites. The campsites do not include a cabin, but a camping unit can be a cabin. And there's, I think it just needs to be cleaned up some.
Yeah.
I mean, there's also the part about an establishment of RV park being subject to conditional zoning or rezoning approval. But yet the RV park is only under conditional, so I'm not sure why the word or would be there.
In case it was a different zone, it would still have to get rezoned to the conditional zone. I think that was the intent behind that sentence.
Correct.
Okay.
And to,
it's kind of obvious, but we found out we've had to spell a few things out for some people.
Correct. And what this would do with the rezoning.
The word would be and, not or.
Oh.
Oh, yeah.
And slash or.
Yeah.
Bah. There we go. And when we talk about rezoning, thank you, in this instance, it wouldn't necessarily be a significant change from the other standards that are allowed and other uses that are allowed in the district. RA would still be an allowed district for RV parks. It would just be RA conditional district. The conditions being, if you are moving forward with this RV park, these will be the conditions that apply. That would be the same in highway commercial also.
Help me understand group camp facilities a little bit, because we're requiring a quarter acre per person camping.
We are. And group camp facilities are something like Camp Carefree or a kid's day camp that might run in the warmer months, or a summer camp of some sort. It could even be potentially a camp for adults that might have special needs or something like that. But it's a place where there may be a combination of tent camping, where there may be cabins, which is where the cabin sort of fleshing out that definition came in. It's not meant for the same types of uses as a recreational vehicle park, if that clarifies any.
It's also existing.
True, and it applies to existing.
This is existing language in the ordinance.
Right, this is nothing new. The language under campground is nothing new. It just takes out and recreational vehicle parks in order to separate those uses out. Does that help?
Yes, that helps.
Thank you for catching that. In number 10, you're correct. wanted to see if there was one other thing I wanted to point out. Is that clear that we did mean, Kevin, I want to make sure, so when we talk about campground and camping unit, is it clear that we mean that a camping unit may include any tent, accessory cabin, lean-to, or similar item? And accessory cabin, we put that in there to be sort of extra cautious to make sure that people don't think these can be principal dwelling units within a campground. You can't have a campground cabin be a principal residential structure. That's why we threw in that word accessory.
Can you say that again?
Sure. Basically, their cabins in the current language, ordinance language, they're already allowed in campgrounds. Cabins, primitive tent camping, RVs, they're all sort of lumped together with some amount of breakout for recreational vehicle parks. We wanted to be sure to be able to keep an allowance for cabins that are for recreational park purposes, like a kid's day camp, but wanted to make sure that they were understood to be accessory uses to the campground, which is the primary use, as opposed to a principal residential structure, someone living in it full-time year-round.
Principal residential structures is what caught my attention, because I think there are places within the county that were intended for exactly what you talked about as recreational temporary housing, particularly in RVs, not necessarily cabins. And I'm apprehensive about anything that will allow another foot in the door to turn RV temporary housing into longer term housing.
That's certainly fair.
Have you not shared this concern?
We've had this concern. We
180 days.
The 180 days is the only semi-rational sort of non-arbitrary number we could come up with to say this will be the maximum length of stay. We've heard different numbers from different folks as suggestions, members of the public, folks who've applied for these things. Different counties handle things differently. I talked to three or four counties before this meeting to see what their rules are. The majority of them did not have a dictated length of stay, but their goals for these parks may be very different from what our goals are. One county for sure, Caswell, has a 180-day limit that they instituted. And that 180-day limit technically means they can pull off the site, come back into a site next door, and stay for another 180 days. It's not much more rocket science than that when it comes down to the actual use.
You're saying the regulation, and it sure sounds like, can be easily avoided.
It could be.
Go around it.
Yeah, to that point, if you will, for example, we've had a lot of construction in this county over the last several years, hospital expansions, new business development, traveling contractors come to an area, they bring a camper, an RV, they may live in it, but they may be on site 2 years. The 180 days, quite frankly, gives me a little bit of a concern in these type situations, because as you pointed out, all you'd have to do is pull out of one space and slide over one, and you've complied with the law, but so you're living in, it just seems like a lot of trouble for nothing in some cases. I don't know the right answer. A couple of other things that we say I'm concerned about. We're talking about the access roadways, and the paragraph before that says a minimum 30-foot right-of-way. If we're going to have DOT suitable construction, I think it'd have to be a 50-foot right-of-way. We had talked about the 200 feet sanitary source of drinking water must be at least 200 feet away, but no more than 400 feet away from toilet facilities. I just have some concern with some of these things. Personally, I would like to see this sent back to the folks that were on the UDO committee originally, and maybe rework some of this, update some of the language that Commissioner Berger had pointed out, And if that means we have to run it back through the planning board, we do. I think we need to get it right if we're making a change. That's my 2 cents worth.
Sure.
Yes, Commissioner Powell.
So would it be possible to put some exemptions under the 180 days? I know what your intentions were, and I'm probably good with that, but there's two things that kind of give me a little heartburn. Commissioner Hall brings forward, there are a lot of construction workers in the county who do stay in the RVs while they're working in the county. Certainly, we don't want to put them to the trouble of moving out of one lot and into the other. So I don't know if we could put some exemptions under there. It says if you're here for construction purposes with a specific job, specific construction job, that you're exempt from that. Or if you're a traveling nurse, for instance, they may do the same thing if they would be exempt from that. The other thing that kind of gives me a little bit of heartburn is the complaint based on the 180 days. And the reason for that is because it could very well be that, me and Kevin are in an RV park and we've got a slot and Charlie wants to put his in there, and so at 181 days he calls in to complain on me and don't call in one on him. I mean, we've had the same thing before, if you remember back in the Connex box thing. We were getting ready to fine a gentleman for having one of those Connex boxes as permanent storage, but when you pulled out of his lot and looked straight across the road, the guy across the road had three of them. Well, it's not quite fair to go out there, and Ben does a great job, it's not quite fair to go out there and threaten to fine this guy because he's in violation of ordinance, but we can literally see right across the street that this man's in violation of it too, but we don't say anything to him simply because we haven't gotten a complaint. And in this case, I could see that actually happening where family comes up here and they get in the campground and want to stay there for a while, and the guy next door hits 181 days and they call him, Ben's going out to tell him he's got to move, and as soon as he pulls off, this guy's friend pulls in. I mean, all kinds of things can happen. I'd like to see us do something. If in this case right here, if we're going to have a complaint base, maybe if it's complaint based, we get a complaint about one person staying there too long. If there's 15 in there, I don't think it takes long to just check them all while you're there and say, this guy's in violation and these guys are in violation, let's just get them all at one time and do it that way.
I did. Some of the other jurisdictions that I talked about, two in particular, did say that it is a requirement of their ordinances that any owner or manager of an RV park make note of dates of check-in and check-out and keep that index available should code enforcement or zoning or building inspections, should someone need to come visit, so that those records are immediately available. If we were to add something like that, with an exception for a certain length of time for certain types of workers, then we get a complaint. Well, okay, let's see your appointment book, sir and ma'am, and we can look it over, and then that would give us sort of an easy reference if we wanted to add that.
That's a much fairer way to do it. And having said that, and based on what Mr. Hall said, I would offer a motion to table this until they've had time to correct this wording and that kind of bring it back to us. Is that something the board would be interested in?
Did Charlie make a motion?
I said I would accept a motion to do that. I would like to see it.
Do we need to specify in the motion that we want this to go back in front of our UDO committee?
That's fine. I mean, you can say it.
We don't have to, but it'd be nice.
I would like to make a motion to table this after it's been sent back in front of the UDO committee to rework the language.
And I'll second that motion.
So we have a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? Very good. Thank you. Thank you.
Real quick.
Yes. Since we've held the public hearing, yes. I don't think there's a need to hold another one unless y'all feel that way. But this would just go under old business on a later meeting, unless you want to reopen the public hearing again. I just need to know so we can advertise properly. There's no requirement that we hold it twice.
He's right. There's no requirement.
Yeah.
So.
But I just want to make sure y'all are comfortable with that. So I don't want to.
I think we are.
Okay.
I don't see us reopening the public hearing for this.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Very good. All right. Our next case is 2024-01B, text amendment.
I will get to work on those corrections and get this emailed out. 2024-01B specifically has to do with new wireless towers and the special use permit that is required to establish those around the county. We've had a specific request from more than one developer, one with tower engineering professionals, and another with an engineering consultant firm working with Duke Energy to update these standards because so much of it has fallen sort of out of date. We have out-of-date UDO references. We have out-of-date statutory references. So a lot of this is technical. In addition to the technical corrections, the definition of the cell tower fall zone was omitted from the 2021 ordinance when we adopted it. Even though it's referred to in the text amendment, we've had developers ask us for clarification on that, so we propose to reintroduce the fall zone as it has been worded in the past, which is the height of the tower plus 10% for guide towers. For monopole towers, there's a slight reduction. And we've also had a specific request having to do on, I think it's the fourth or fifth page of this, yes, in Section D, setbacks. If a proposed tower is to have engineered features to reduce its fall zone equal to a number less than the total height tower, plus 10%, the applicant may submit a full set of engineering plans discussing this point to our third-party engineering review crew at Atlantic Technologies. If Atlantic Technologies says that, yes, we believe this is a safe and regular feature and we recommend approval of this adjusted fall zone height, it builds in flexibility for new types of towers that are coming down the road that we're seeing more of that we never really saw in the past. That's where that came from. The other things are just simple updates to match language in the ordinance about landscape standards. And the other significant parts of it have to do with tower performance and security and removal security, financial guarantees, performance bonds. Currently, the language states that there's a minimum $30,000 bond that must be issued at the time of permittal to cover the cost of decommissioning if and when that happens. There's been a stronger push across the state for towers, for solar energy facilities, for several of these types of things to have more robust guarantees as far as bonds, letters of credit, whatever type of security instrument is used as far as a financial guarantee. So the ordinance amendment proposes to essentially set up at the beginning, at the application cost, if approved by the special use permit, a bond or letter of credit, some sort of performance guarantee, will be maintained by the applicant as approved by the county attorney for 125% of the cost of total cost of decommissioning. And it's just essentially held in trust for the life of the tower until it is decommissioned or becomes inoperable. And that was the those are the major highlights that I wanted to hit about that. And just note that, again, this has been requested, which is why we're bringing it back to you guys.
Gentlemen, are there any questions before you open the public hearing?
Quick clarification, if
yes,
I may.
Sir.
So no longer 30,000 bond, but 125% of the total cost is required reservation?
The 125% of the total cost of the decommissioning, and the cost of decommissioning would be determined by a licensed engineer or the sort, which is the same that we require for other types of improvements across the county, whether it be roads in major subdivisions, sewer facilities. It's what we're kind of proposing for an update to the solar energy policy, but yes, it'll go up from 30,000 to 125% of the total decommissioning cost. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I can just tell you, you can't take it down for $30,000.
That's what I'm saying. You can't take it down for $30,000. Yeah.
Any further questions? With that, we'll open the public hearing. And no one has signed up to speak on this issue. Is there anyone here who would like to speak to it? Nothing seen. With that, we'll close the public hearing. Gentlemen, any further discussion? Any questions?
Motion to approve.
Is there a second? Very good. Motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Very good. Motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Our next item is case 2024-02, zoning map amendment.
Yes, this is a zoning map amendment to request to take a parcel that is split zoned highway commercial and residential agricultural to solidly highway commercial. Its location is 7720 NC Highway 87, just right outside of here in Wentworth on the way to Reedsville. This is a conventional rezoning. The planning board heard this on January 8th at their meeting and recommended approval at 7-0. You can see our vicinity map literally is just outside of Wentworth. Here's the zoning map. This is surrounded by a lot of RA, but as you clearly see across the street is Chandler and all their highway, heavy industrial, and that heavy industrial and commercial and O&I continues on through to the intersection. A little bit further zoomed out so you can see how far that goes. This is in the Troublesome Creek watershed. And our main use map does have this classified as O2, which does not support this type of zoning, but clearly the factors around it show that this would be a reasonable request due to the nature of the surrounding area. It is our belief that this area should be allowed for further study to handle the commercial corridor that it apparently was going to be and then was not reviewed properly, in our opinion, in the land use plan. But here's a screenshot of the property. So you can see that there's a wood lot behind the current uses. They'll be expanding that use slightly, but they want to rezone the entire parcel to keep it consistent. Again, this is in our O2 rural land class, which is not which does not support this use, but we do find it reasonable because of the nature of the surrounding parcels. Also, we do find it consistent with the economic development goals of our land use plan, which call for us to support our existing businesses and their expansions. Again, we find this reasonable. So if you have any further questions, put the...
Well, let's go ahead and open the public hearing. Public hearing is now open, and we do not have anybody signed up to speak on this. Is the applicant here tonight? Would you like to speak? Well, I tell you what, if we have some questions, we may bring you up later. And with that, we don't have anyone signed up. Does anyone else would want to speak on this issue? With that being said, we'll close the public hearing for now, and we'll entertain questions from the board. Gentlemen, bless you. Does anyone have questions?
Chair, I'd like a motion to approve this now. I don't have any of that magic language here, so.
There should be an ordinance in your packet. You just have to adopt the ordinance amending the map.
We have the packet.
I think that's all you need.
Motion to approve the resolution.
All right. Very good. So we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Well, congratulations.
That's all the magic you need.
That was a great speech.
Can I say not particularly
from now on?
Yes, sir. With that, we have Mr. Ronnie Tate, Director of Engineering and Public Utilities.
One item tonight for your consideration is approval of Mosley Architects to provide county facility space needs study. You had the proposal attached in your packet, and the funding for this is $99,445, and it's coming from Capital Improvement Plan, Engineering and Public Utilities Building Expansion. I can hit the highlights or I can answer questions, whatever the board prefers.
Gentlemen, do we have any questions? Well, this was put out for bid, right? And we had several responses. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. That is correct. We had four, I think, responses back to the RFQ.
And you had a committee get together and evaluated the proposals, and this was the best value. Is that what I understand?
Yes, sir. That's correct. And it was approved by Facility and Grounds Committee also.
Any questions? No questions?
Just, wait a minute, just for the public's. This report could bring back suggestions for using existing space, because, or it could also come back with suggestions for building something for increased space. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. That is correct. Yeah. In the best records I can find, the last one that was performed was sometime in the early 2000s. In looking at the schematic plans for that, they actually had concepts of locating several departments in the old courthouse building. So that's early on in the 2000s before the new courthouse was built and all. So it's been a while since anyone has looked at this.
Any other questions? Comments? With that, we'll entertain a motion to approve or deny.
And if you'll approve the budget amendment too, please. If you approve it.
Mr. Chair, I make a motion to approve this need study as submitted in scope and in cost for county facilities and approve the budget amendment from finance for the project.
Thank you, Commissioner Barrett. We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
There's a second. Thank you, Commissioner Richardson. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you, Jim.
Very good. Thank you. With that, new business. Mr. Manager, is there any new business? With that, we'll go to Commissioner comments, and we'll start as usual with Commissioner Barrow.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would just like to thank Ms. Paula and the rest of the staff over at the Board of Elections. I went by the other day to ask her how things were going with early voting. We were just talking about protocols with the new voter ID. She informed me that we have had no issues in the county with voter ID. Everybody's had their IDs when they showed up and have been able to vote. So I just want everybody to know that things are going smoothly on that. Also, in our consent agenda tonight, we approved the county cleanup week, which is our no-charge week at the landfill for April the 22nd through April the 27th. So be on the lookout for that. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner Barrow. Commissioner Richardson?
Thank you. I appreciate making these comments because I particularly wanted to congratulate the Richmond Community College and Rockingham Community College on signing a joint agreement today that will enhance the availability of 911 training and hopefully improve emergency response, not just here in our counties, but throughout the state. And I think this is particularly significant because in the past, I felt like that the competition between community college wasn't always bringing forth the best results. And so, and I was pleased to see that Senator Berger and Representative Pirtle made comment to the fact that this collaboration is much better than a competition. And I want to congratulate them and those of you that might be interested in an emergency response sort of career should find it available real soon over at the community college. It does fill a statewide need. I'd also like to recognize Mrs. Felissa Farrell of our own social services and human health services department here. She's done a tremendous job, and you don't often get to see her because she's busy back in the multiple offices that she administers. She oversaw the consolidation of our health and human services with social services and has done a good job there, has worked very hand in glove with our county manager to make that go smoothly and seek out economies. She's overseen the two changes in LME MCOs, which has a great impact on those people within our county that have both mental health or physical health needs. And I've been watching from a distance as I watch her preparations to deal with Medicaid expansion, which will be of significant benefit to many of the residents here in the county. So if you see Felissa Farrell, thank her for a job extremely well done, saving of county assets and serving the public well.
That's all I have.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Berger?
Just thank everyone for tuning in tonight and for coming to the meeting. Thank you.
Commissioner Powell?
Yes, sir. I, too, would like to thank you for coming to the meeting and tuning in. I'd like to recognize our elected officials tonight. Our Sheriff Sam Page is back with us, and Paula Rakestraw, our school board member, was here earlier. She attends regularly, so we appreciate her involvement in the community and the commissioner's business. Thank you.
Well, thank you, everyone, for your attendance tonight. We appreciate all those watching at home as well. And with that, we will recess. I think we're going into closed session tonight. And so we, at this point, we will accept a motion to go into closed session pursuant to NCGS 143-318-11A1 and NCGS 143-318-11A6. Do I have a motion?
Moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
With that, we'll be in closed session. I do not anticipate business coming up after this. So with that, our next meeting will be March 4th at 6:30 here in the Governmental Center. Thank you. We are in closed session.